Hi, Joe.
Hi, guys.
It's good to be with you today.
Same here.
I brought my bride, my Ann, here, and
almost 38 years.
Almost 38 years.
So we're really fortunate.
We sure are.
That's great.
We have three sons, all married.
What are your sons' names?
Our oldest son is Jim, and
they have three grandsons. We have three grandsons.
And our oldest son has three sons.
Right.
Our daughter.
Our three sons, Jim, Bill, and Tom. Jim is married and has three sons. Bill is married and has one daughter. And our son, Tom, had married Espy last spring.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. It's a Friday, and it's 10:10, and it's a windy day, and we had a real bad wind, too, didn't we?
We had a gale yesterday. Gale force winds over 40 miles an hour, and the beach is transformed.
Really, there's a lot of beach lost.
It's really, really something.
I'm going to have to go down there today and take a look. Great. Well, thank you very much, Ann and Bud, and I'll just turn this off, and we'll start again. Thank you very much. Say goodbye if you want.
Goodbye. I'm going to the post office.
Okay.
We should have a... Oh, careful, honey.
That's okay.
Did I get you?
No, that's fine.
No problem. No problem at all.
We got sort of... Oh, watch it, honey.
I'm doing it again.
Go around dear.
That's showbiz, you know? That's why they have technicians and grip boys and everything else, I guess. We don't have that.
That should have been done over, I'm sure.
Well, I didn't... I don't know why, they just take a while to get going. Okay, Mr. Hartman, would you please give your full name and date of birth?
Joe, my full name is George Herbert Hartman, Jr., and my date of birth is December 21st,
1928. Okay. Can you give me a background on how your family came to come to White Lake and your family background, your mother, your father, your members of the family that are here still in short, just basically your family tree here at Sylvan Beach. It sounds simple, but kind of a tall order, I guess.
Okay. My first summer at Sylvan Beach was when I was 6 months old. And my parents came to the Sylvan Beach Hotel for 2 weeks. And we liked it so much, or they liked it so much, that they kept coming year after year. And when my sister was born 3 years after I, the four of us would come up every summer. As near as I can recollect, we stayed at the cottage right in the middle, where the I'm trying to think where the Bogarts more recently and the Kipparts are now. And it was kind of curious because I remember hearing my parents say that, every time we have guests, why the skunks that live underneath us let fly. And it seemed like on cue, the little family that was residing with us would make their presence known. We stayed in the Koval Cottage after that, and that's where the Hartz Cottage is now. It was torn down, and the Hartz family built their present house. After that, my parents purchased the Norris Cottage, where Joe Hartman is now, and we as kids grew up most of our years there. Cottage we're in now, while this movie's going on, was the old Forbes Cottage. And my parents bought this one, I think around 1945, as near as I can recall. And for years rented it until we were old enough, my sister and I, with our families, to come up here, each having a month. So I think that's it, Joe, in terms of where we stayed and all that sort of thing.
Okay. Just a question. When you came to White Lake or Sylvan Beach, what was the first thing you did each summer that you came here? When you got here as a kid, did you have one certain thing that all year round you waited for or you were going to do?
Absolutely.
Can you tell us what that was?
Fishing at the dock.
Oh, fishing, great. Now, what did you do when your dad pulled in? Did you jump out of the car and run down there?
Well, the first thing we had to do was to assemble our gear and dig worms. In the back of the house, we used to do that, and we used to use these little tobacco cans, these Prince Albert cans, and we'd fill it in with dirt and night crawlers and go down to the dock and try our luck.
Oh, that's great. Speaking of fishing, do you have any fishing stories that you've had during your life? Big fish, small fish, a fish that got away, things that you've seen, something funny, something different, something that you remember about fishing around here?
I was never particularly lucky or good, depending on which affects the catching fish. There were some awfully good fishermen here. Lou Middleton was a great fisherman, Ed McCobb, and I used to go out with Lou Middleton in the afternoon. He had a place that he caught smallmouth black bass on the other side of the lake near the yacht club. And we'd go over there about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and sure enough, we'd have luck. But when I went out alone, I wasn't very successful.
What type of fish did you like to fish? What did you usually fish for? What was your favorite fish?
Well, given the fact that we're using worms for the most part, sunfish, perch, bluegills, rock bass, there was a lot of rock bass, was pretty much what we did as young kids. And as we got older, we went after large and smallmouth black bass using minnows and pike.
Okay, northern pike.
And we use the lure, you know, we cast it a little bit too with the
cast the lure.
The bassarino.
What do you think of, have you seen any, are there more fish now or less fish, or what do you think?
We had exciting fish years, of course, on the big channel. Every July, there'd be a perch run, and we'd catch a perch up to 12 inches, maybe 100 a day. It was just wonderful. The white bass was very prevalent during the 30s and 40s, and they'd hang out right around Murray's Inn, Driftwood now, in that area, and minnows was the preferred bait, and they were a wonderful fish. They'd run, early August. And I remember one year was when World War II started, August of 39, and we had a wonderful fish run, perch all over White Lake. I've never seen so many perch in White Lake. For 1 year. After that, they just seemed to go away.
What do you think caused that? What do you think caused the depletion of fish around here?
It's hard to tell why we had those bonus years of wonderful fishing for perch that 1 year in 39. It was an aberration of some kind. People. When you have population, you have everything attended to it. And you had the industry in the Whitehall area. You had fertilizing of lawns, which gets down to the water table, which feeds into the lake eventually. The tannery was a big culprit during those years. The story goes that they used to throw skins in the bottom of White Lake.
Yeah.
And that didn't do us White Lake any favors. Beyond that, the natural predators, the lamprey eel, what else? There was something else. Now we have the zebra mussels.
Alewife, too.
Oh, the alewife. Oh, sure. They all affect the bait cycle, the ecological cycle of fish.
Do you still fish?
No, I don't, and I'm going to start doing it again.
Oh, great.
Yeah, all right.
Great. Well, I'll have to come back and ask you then if it's better or worse than before. Your father, George Hartman, is probably one of the most unique, great, wonderful characters that's ever been here. Could you tell us something about him, what George did for a job, and what some of the special things about George?
Well, he was a special person. I never knew anybody that was liked by more people than he, and that had others in mind in everything he did. This was a favorite spot. You'd rather spend time at White Lake than do anything else that I can think of. He loved the golf club. He was a big part of that. He was president of the golf club during a number of years and secretary treasurer for close to 20. And he was commodore of the yacht club, and he was also president of the Sylvan Beach Resort Company. It was the triple.
Exactly.
And I don't think I've known anybody that's done the triple.
No.
So he's given an awful lot of time. He did things that maybe some people don't know. For example, a lighthouse. The lighthouse after World War II was going to be torn down. It was government owned, and along with other lighthouses around the Great Lakes, discontinued. And my father heard about it, and he said, gee whiz, how can we save this thing? And so he found out what he could do, and called up some of his good friends. And I hesitate to mention those friends because I may leave somebody out, Joe.
Okay,
and but Art Children, as near as I can recall, and Homer Hartz, and I think there were others. And rather than give credit only to them, I'd like to do some research and find out. Maybe we can edit this little dissertation. So he said, he called these guys up and said, like to have you join me for lunch. I'm paying, but bring your checkbook. So these guys all met George for lunch, and he told them what he had on his mind, and they all opened their checkbooks and wrote out a check, and they bought the lighthouse and then donated it to the township. And of course, before all this happened, Dad had to check the township and say, hey, would you accept this as a gift?
Yes.
And they said yes.
What was the point of giving it to the township? What was
preserve the lighthouse that would have been torn down.
Okay, Sylvan Beach.
And yes. Now, as we know, it's a museum, and it's a wonderful place for this area.
Okay.
And
did they ever have any idea of trying to keep it, maybe, or just they just bought it and gave it to the township, and that kind
right.
of washed their hands of the situation.
Right.
We weren't responsible then.
That's right. And but the big thing was that we had to talk to the township, find out if they would accept it, and they said yes, and it was done. And the rest is history. We have a wonderful place to go and visit.
Yes.
And but there were others, Joe, as well, and
right.
I certainly.
We'll certainly check.
And their ways of doing it. Actually, I think there's a plaque down there that indicates the first year, and that might be a starting point. And it would be 1946 to 50, right in there. And then you could check the minutes at the township.
Good idea, minutes.
And starting with that date on the plaque. And see what that says, and then we know our facts. Yeah.
Great, it's a good idea. What business was your father in?
He was in the advertising agency field. He had his own company. He bought a company. Oh boy, can we stop that? We've got the telephone.
Okay, we have about a 3-second lag time. 2, 3. Okay. Talking about your father, Bob.
Right, and I hope the phone doesn't ring again.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, as I indicated before, he was always looking forward and trying to find ways to improve the beach here and do as the best he could do in whatever job he had. He started the Commodore's Ball, for example. It was his thought that the Commodores and their wives, past Commodores, should be honored in some way each summer. And so one of the dances and the dinner preceding, they had a Commodore's table for all the past Commodores, and that was the tradition that was started.
Do you remember what year that was, by any chance?
Well, it was, I think I was in the service, and I'd like to say 1952, not positive. I think your dad would maybe come up with the answer there.
Okay. What else did George do? We were talking about his business. Can you tell us a bit more about...
Oh, one other thing before we go into the business. It just occurred to me, getting back to Sylvan, he was always concerned about safety. And as I know, many parents at Sylvan were concerned through the years. Remember how we used to walk down to the dock, the arcade area, on that little narrow sidewalk that had no space between the road. And the road was narrow and winding, and little kids would walk down right next to the road with very close to cars. And so he felt the need for an interior walk. So one summer he had a bunch of us help him clear the way on top of that retaining wall where the current walk stands, and that became then the beginning of a inner path that exists today. So just a thought. Things like that, he was always looking for ways to help to make things more safe and...
generally better.
Yeah, right.
That's fascinating.
But you were asking a question on something else.
No, I just, that's great. Just about your dad's business. I understand he was a very successful ad man.
Okay. He started right after college. He was a very good golfer, a champion golfer. He played. He could have played the circuit if he was able to.
What college, by the way?
University of Chicago. He and my mother both graduated from Chicago.
And what did he get his degree in?
History, as I remember. But he worked his way through through college, and he had jobs. Along the way, in fact, he used to take a streetcar at 3 in the morning and then transfer to another streetcar to get to his job, and then he worked whatever he did, and then he went to school too, and he played golf at the University of Chicago. He was Big Ten champion for 3 years, and he was runner-up at the Western Amateur, and had won numerous tournaments, great golfer. And that helped him get started in business, because the old expression, you know, you make close a lot of deals on the golf course business. And it helped him, I'm sure, in the advertising agency field. And he finally sold out his company, I think, in 1962.
Okay. And then he retired then, basically?
Retired after 5 years. He stayed on for 5 years and retired. After that,
if you think of something else down the line here about your father, and you want to say it, just pipe up and say it. Because again, he was
A whole lot of ideas will come after the mic is turned off, and I'll say, "Oh my gosh, I wish I'd thought of that."
That always happens.
Yeah. You should have let me know what your questions were in advance.
Yeah. Well, you know, we thought about doing it that way, but then everybody kind of gets tied down into that, and then they aren't comfortable doing it. I mean, you know, you can't flow.
And we'd maybe get a little too windy, too, because we'd be all prepared to do
hours.
The good job, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, that's a good
question. If you have any other questions, I'll try and deal with those and come back to my father.
Okay, sounds good. As long as we're talking about your father, can you name or tell me some of the most notable characters that you could remember growing up here? People you knew that came to White Lake that were characters, or just like a Joe Sedoni, like memories of people that were just outstanding or different or important?
Sure. Indian Joe, does he come up with any of your other interviews?
No, he hasn't, but I do know.
And he had a house right on the Michelinda Road, and I think he was one of our traffic people down at the arcade area. You know, we had quite a bit of traffic, and we actually had somebody that sort of stopped cars, made sure they'd stop, and somebody down there. And I think he worked there, or maybe he was a night watchman or something here for a while. But anyway, he was a character, and we all knew him. He kept his hair down with black shoe polish. He was a character.
Yeah, didn't he just kind of live in this kind of a shack?
What was it? Was it Indian Joe, or that was what we called him? But what was his name?
I don't remember.
Let's find out from somebody else. Somebody else will remember.
Because later on, he lived above the Norris's cottage down near Hairpin.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he finished up there. I've talked to people who remember him down there.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's. I think that's where he ended up finally. And okay. There's still a tiny foundation up there of a place that was there.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, at least that's what I've been told.
Mm-hmm. Well, we could maybe Tommy would know some answers.
Yeah. We have to. That's a good name. Can you think of some more names?
Characters. Characters are interesting people. Well, the Sidoni family, as we know, are wonderful, wonderful, not characters, but they're just outstanding. Joseph Sidoni's book documents a lot of the things that he's done and he's experienced, and lots of famous people have been guests at his home. I think it goes on. I think his book names a few. I think Franklin Roosevelt and... Well, Sophie Tucker used to come to the Yacht Club, as we know, for dances. Oh, here's a little anecdote. My father, one time, Sophie Tucker was between songs and said, and my father shouted up and said, "Sing one of the old songs, Sophie." And she was irate, because that meant that she was older, you know. And so she really blasted my father. I forget what transpired, but. It was really, really funny. And Dad would told the story. He kept telling the story through the years, so I'm not betraying any thing that was sensitive to him. But isn't that funny?
Oh, that's a riot.
But Sophie Tucker, and then we had the Tar Baby, the boat that came in that was owned by the
Amos and Andy.
Amos and Andy, yeah. They came in.
Play golf,
right. Wayne King used to visit the Sidonis. But Judy Rogers could fill you in on much more than I. And of course, Art and Joe were fixtures on the lake. They were involved in the yacht club, Commodores. They sailed A boats.
Did you ever race on any?
Never did. Never did. And that was a little before I was active in racing here on the lake. And then they had this lifeguard boat called Polaris. And they used to cruise up and down and patrol races and sometimes go out and haul some boats in that were in trouble in Lake Michigan.
Actually,
Art and Joe Sidoni. And Jack DeFraga, who was a good friend of theirs during those years. And this is all pre-war.
Okay. Speaking of that, you were born in 28. Do you have any memories of the Depression?
As an infant, I had a tough time dealing with that. I do remember the 30s. It can be argued that the Depression wasn't over until the war, and so the 30s were tough for a lot of people. The cottages here were certainly not as posh as they are today. We used to heat our water. We used the pot-bellied stove and put in wood and coal. And it was 10 o'clock in the morning before we had anything hot, water-wise. I think we had a refrigerator. Yeah, we did. But we also had an ice box in the garage with the Waller brothers, big 50-pound chunks of ice. And that went on until after World War II.
Okay, now was the ice brought in from the lake during the off-season and then brought to you? Is that how you...
Well, the ice was cut, I suppose, out in... Well, where the water's clean, and stored, of course, until summer, and then trucked out here, and the ice truck would be motoring up through the area, and dripping water, of course, and we were always trying to get one little chunk of ice to suck on, and it was fun to see the old ice truck circulating around here.
Do you remember what a block of ice cost?
Gee, I have no idea. Okay. Nothing to speak of, I'm sure. And all hand-delivered, you know, right to our ice box.
Did you have phones at all?
My father never had a phone. He felt that when he came up here, he didn't want to have to talk to the office. He used the Sylvan Beach Hotel phone Tuesday night at 6 o'clock. He'd call my mother. And anything that she would... Oh, Joe, there's that phone again.
And then we were talking about the phones. So the your father would use the Sylvan Beach Hotel for the phone.
Right, but he wouldn't call the office every day like I do. I'm crazy. I do just what he preached against.
Against, yeah. Not resting, right. During your life, what are some of the, you played a lot of tennis in your life. Mm-hmm. What are some of the outstanding tennis stories that you can remember, and people, male and female, that played tennis? Just characters, different times, things that happen on the tennis courts.
Some things I probably couldn't, I wouldn't be on the record for. interesting people. Well, there's Parker Terryberry is today still playing tennis and does a wonderful job. But in the early going, he was a very active tennis player. Going back a little further than that, when I was a kid, of course we had those old cement courts with the little building in the center, the sort of a little shelter with a roof, and that's where the umpires with judges stand deal. And I guess during the 20s, before my time, they had some big names. George Lott came out here. He was one of the best doubles player in the that ever was, and he was a friend of the Vanderventer guys, Bill and Phil Van, and he would come up, and they'd have an awful lot of good tennis in the 20s, I understand. And again, maybe that was a reason for the judges' stand in the center. After that, of course, the courts were run down, there were cracks all over the place, and we as kids would play. And we'd play barefooted, you know, there were no rules, we didn't wear white, we just wore whatever we had on. We had a lot of good fun, young Bill Hodgson and Ollie and Charlie Abel, the Abel boys, Don and Strat Harrison from around the lake. Oh gosh, it goes on and on, I don't want to miss any names. And of course the gals, the Vanderventer gals would play, and my sister was active, and but again, it was very unstructured. It was sandlot tennis, and we didn't play very well, but we played often. Then as we got some of us a little better, and a few of us took some lessons back home, and we'd come back, and we'd start playing with the men, and there'd be visiting people that would show up on weekends that were pretty darn good, and so we had some good tennis.
What are some of the more notable players that you can remember from Sylvan Beach down? You mentioned Phil Van and his father. Are there some more names
Okay. Again, tennis was not not like golf. It was not a curiosity either, but it wasn't played that much around here and maybe throughout the country. I was involved in the activities when I was in high school, the program with the young kids here at Sylvan. And one of the big parts of it was the tennis program, mainly because of my interest in tennis. So I knew...
Well, that was a summer job?
Yeah, a summer job. And I did this kind of the same thing at Michelinda. So we'd have a tennis tournament at the end of the summer between Sylvan and Michelinda. And sometimes we'd have it there, and sometimes we'd have it here. And that went on for about 3 years, or 2 years, 3 years, during the... early war years, World War II. And that was fun because that enabled the kids from both places to get to know each other, and we had
so
good
that
competition.
Was a kids' tennis.
Yeah,
competition.
Yeah,
well, that's a
right.
Good idea.
And
you were speaking about the Second World War. What are your memories of the war as a child? What do you remember about it up here, rationing? What did you go through? What did you think as a child about this cataclysm?
I was a student of World War II. I always was interested in history, and as a kid, I knew every battle. I knew every general, every admiral, you know. And I listened to Gabriel Heater every night, and I was really a student because of my interest in the whole subject. Then, of course, I just happened to miss being drafted. The war was over before I actually took my induction physical. I took my pre-induction physical, but it was over before I had a chance to get in. I got in the Korean War, the next one, but I missed World War II. A lot of my friends, of course, were in it. Rationing was a big factor. Victory Gardens. Not as many as I did in the Korean War, mainly because most of my friends were of the Korean War age, and the ones I lost were mainly there, although a lot of friends or people that I knew that weren't close friends of mine were lost in that war, yeah.
When you were up here during the Second World War, did you have blackouts? Did you do anything? Did you collect pots and pans, steel drives, or anything like that?
We saved aluminum foil, and my parents did all that, you know, yeah. these things. Victory Gardens, I think we had back home, but not here. There's not enough sun to
sand.
But I think the gas rationing was the thing that impacted us the most to get up here. Yeah, we had the regular, whatever that A sticker was. We certainly didn't have a B or a C, which it would enable us to have plenty of gas. So we had to marshal up enough coupons in order to get the gas to get up here and back.
So that was a problem. I mean, it was something that you were concerned with. I mean, you know, we had to get enough stamps to get gasoline to come to White.
Sure.
Now, was that a very long drive for you from Chicago at that time?
It was in those days because it was before the superhighways, and we'd go through all the towns, the
Michigan
Saugatucks,
City,
the South Haven. We'd always eat at South Haven. That was our halfway spot. And we'd eat at Holly's Grill, which was the old train. It was a Pullman train, and that became the diner. And we'd eat there inside the main part of town as a halfway point on our trip from Chicago.
Okay. But back to the Second World War again. Do you remember the day that it came to an end up here?
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us about that day? And did you have an idea that it was coming? The end of the war was coming. The Germans were out of it by then, but the Japanese were still going. Did you feel that we were going to have to invade Japan?
Well, as soon as the atomic bomb was dropped, it was fait accompli. It was everybody had the feeling, including me, that it was over. It was a tragic thing because you know the bomb was so hideous. We knew it meant the end of the war. We were saving many, many thousands of lives as a result. If it hadn't been for the bomb, those Japanese would be holed up in every little nook and cranny, and we would have lost many, many men, good people. So we were thankful that we could save those lives. On the other hand, it was so hideous that it was hard to deal with at the time.
Yeah, good feeling.
BJ Day was a big celebration day. It was in August. I remember it. We had a big bonfire down.
Do you remember what you were doing when you heard the war came to an end? And I guess I want to preface this by saying, when the atomic bomb was dropped, did you pick up the paper one day and see the bomb had been dropped and you never heard about it? Is that basically the effect that you had?
Heard it on the radio. Yeah,
when
Pearl Harbor happened. I know exactly where I was. We heard it on the radio. My mother came in. We heard it. My dad and I were listening to the Bears and the Cardinals play in a football game on radio, and they interrupted the game and told us about Pearl Harbor. I can't remember exactly where I physically was when I heard that the Japanese had surrendered. All I kind of remember is a big bonfire and all the happiness that the war was over. And
do you remember again, when that atomic bomb was dropped, which was only a few days before the Japanese gave up? Did they announce that immediately that the atomic bomb had been dropped? Did they use the words atomic bomb? Did you hear of it?
I had not heard of it. Yes, they used the word atomic bomb. We all wondered how it could have been developed. We heard all about Stagg Field, and it was underneath Stagg Field, and the names of Oppenheimer and so on that we'd never heard of before suddenly became names that were very important. Yeah.
Was the terror of the atomic bomb, did you realize that immediately? I mean, did you?
Yeah.
You did know immediately that what we'd unleashed was
The magnitude, the devastation, the hideousness of it. Nagasaki as well as Hiroshima. Yeah, it was. We immediately knew that this was something that was going to change history, and
thank God
we didn't like the bomb, but we were glad that we could get the war over with without losing lives, any more lives.
Yeah, a decision that had to be made, I think. Past the war, when did you used to sail, and can you tell us about your sailing years here at White Lake?
Yep. Years ago, my parents bought a crescent with the Vanderventer family. It was called Daisy, and theirs was the moving van. And they were parked out on the White Lake side, right next to each other. It looked like two little ducks. The crescent was not my favorite boat. It was tippy and small, and it just wasn't my favorite boat.
About what age were you, though?
Oh, cry, I was grammar school age, you know. And then we, of course, went to sailing school, and the sea boat was the boat that was the popular one, and we all wanted one. We finally got one, and we purchased Betty Hartz's 1940 Palmer in 1942, and I think we paid $600 for it, and raced it for, 12, 15 years. In fact, wait, longer than that. Because I got out of the service and we still had it. And Tom McMurray and I raced it on White Lake, which would have been about 1953. So that was an old boat.
Yeah, that was a problem.
Then we raced E-boats. Tom and I decided we saw each other over in Germany. We were stationed over there during the Korean War. And we decided to buy an e-boat together, and we did. And when we both were mustered out of the service, we raced it together for about the better part of 10 years, and we had three e-boats that we went through in the course of those years, and those were marvelous. We had 28 E's on White Lake, and it was, when you think that there are at least three people as normal crew for an e-boat, sometimes four, you know, multiply 3 times 4 times 28, and you've got a lot of people interested in the class. And the E's were fabulous. We had the National Regatta, forget the date, I think it was around 63, 64, and lots of wonderful sailing and great memories.
Great. Who were some of the great sailors? Just some of the ones.
Mean in Inland Lake or around the.
Right here at White Lake.
Mackinac type stuff. White Lake. Bill Hodgson was probably the best sailor I knew and or ran up against. Tom Getz was outstanding. Dwayne Pearson, Bruce Stewart. Bob Christie was sailing a lot. Jack Chatain. Again, I don't want to miss anybody, but it goes on and on. The Partridges, Neil Manny, of course, but, he won the Western Michigan regatta as well. And, I could go on and on if I could think.
That's great. We were talking about golf. Who were some of the great golfers that you golfed with up here or knew of?
I never played golf. I played tennis a lot. I sailed a lot, and I let Dad take care of the golf for the family, and I regret that. I would have loved to have taken the time to play what I consider one of the greatest games around, and that is golf. But I never did it, Joe.
You never did it?
Yeah.
I didn't either. Just too busy doing something else. This is of course a little bit back in your time, but you might be able to have some memories or some tales that you heard of. Prohibition. Did you have any memories of Prohibition, or did your dad have any stories about Prohibition?
Well, you're talking the 20s. That really predates me. All I know about it, but I don't have any firsthand stories.
Stories to tell. Okay.
Right.
Okay. Can you tell us something about the arcade during your life?
Sure.
Okay. What were your first memories of the arcade? And did you used to hang around the arcade a lot as
yep.
a kid?
Or yep.
Just give me a date, an average day at the arcade.
I have very warm memories of the arcade dock area. It was the focal point of activity. It was, and growing up, I was always hungry. That's where the candy bars were. That's where the Byerly's soft drink was. We used to buy frozen candy bars that we just loved. The Three Musketeers, the Powerhouses, those candy bars we'd buy. And it just was a marvelous place because it had all these goodies. And the arcade on one side, as you undoubtedly know, was kind of a drugstore, soda fountain, with a little porch in the back. And we'd drink soft drinks and out on that porch. And there were little holes in the screen, so we'd drop the bottle caps into White Lake, you know, dumb things like that. On the other side was a grocery store. I think the Kern operation ran it, both sides, I think. And that never did as well. It wasn't big enough to stock enough product to really make it hard to or easy to make a go. But they tried, and that was on the other side. And I guess there were some living quarters on top.
Did anybody ever live on top?
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't know that. And then there was the Shop Valhalla, which Carmi Garin had next door, which was the little building. The dock sort of extended, not only went out in kind of an L, but it also, at the arcade level, sort of went wider to encompass the Shop Valhalla, and it was a little bit more than just the dock that protruded out into the lake.
Where were the boats coming in at that time, the Carolina?
No, that was way before me. That was during the 20s, and I don't remember that.
Okay.
When
you were growing up, then, of course, the Sylvan Beach Hotel was still there.
Sure did, and we used to play games in the basement.
Oh, you're kidding. What, would you just go down in there in the basement?
Oh, yeah, it was open, and no, not games, hide-and-seek and giants and ants and capture the flag, and it was a honeycomb underneath the thing, and we had hiding places underneath the hotel, and we'd run around the porches, and I don't know how they let it. It probably did, but we were able to do it. You know, it was very curious. The Sylvan Beach Hotel was such a marvelous place, but can you imagine having fire escapes made of wood? You know, the ladders that were coming down, there were wooden ladders. Everything was wood. Well, anyway.
Thank God it never burned.
That's right.
Do you remember the arcade being taken down or the hotel being taken down? Do you remember? Was there anybody that tried to save, for instance, at the arcade?
Not to my knowledge. No.
We're still in that frame of mind.
Yeah.
Tear things down and build new things.
Right. I think it was probably falling in disrepair, and it was a pretty... Somebody'd have to soak some money into it to build it up and make it okay. The post office was there too. That was in the back. I think there's some postcards that exist around here that show that post office existing.
What was the just as a thought, when the arcade was torn down and when the hotel was torn down, did that hurt you as a child? I mean, did you come up one summer and those things?
Yeah, all our hiding places were gone. And the hotel was fun, too, because you could buy candy there as well.
Yeah.
So that was a place that we always kind of liked. Our memory still is the hotel was such a big place. And yet, when we see the footprint of where the hotel must have rested, I can't imagine it being so small. There's a tree there today in the old parking lot of the hotel. It's right in back of Jackman's, between Rudolph's and Jackman's house. It's a big beech, I think, and it's one of those things where you and I can't reach around it. It's so massive, and you look up, and it's a cathedral of of branches. That was the place that we used as the tree that was like kick the can. We didn't have a can, we used the tree instead of kicking it. And that became our one of the centers for the game that we played.
And the tree is still,
and it's still there, and it's kind of neat to see every year.
Oh, yeah.
It was right in the middle of the parking lot.
Oh,
no, we just remembered it fondly.
What a neat, man, what a wonderful, yeah, to be able to go look at that thing. And,
yeah.
Yeah, if trees could only talk.
Right.
What was, just a different topic here, what was the biggest wedding or the most memorable wedding that you can remember here at Sylvan Beach?
Barb Van was married, Jim Wagner, one August. And we went through the hottest period I've ever experienced at in Michigan. For 1 week, it was blistering hot, unlike anything that I've ever experienced up here or anywhere. And normally, kids aren't bothered by, or young people aren't bothered by heat. I was bothered. We were all bothered. And it was a very wonderful, large wedding on, you know, the Vanderventer property. And very memorable. I do remember that
remember
one.
That. Speaking of memories again, what was some of the more memorable jinxes and jinx acts that you were in?
Every one that you you ran. So too. That was this summer, yeah.
Do you remember any jinx acts from your age that are memorable to you?
Yeah, I remember I had a pretty big part. We used to have talking parts as well as skits. It wasn't just song and dance. There were actual little mini plays and things like that. And I had some fairly important part in a mini play, and I didn't learn my lines. And it was one of these things that, well, when I get up there on the night, it'll all come to me, right?
Yeah,
yeah, right. Instead, I got a little scared, and I really drew a blank.
Oh, no.
So we had some very short curtains.
Oh, my God. Oh, I bet.
And the prompters, you know, behind, you know, they were yelling at me.
Oh, that's horrible.
Yeah, that is.
Horrible.
I only made that mistake once.
Oh, boy. And what did your dad say? Did your dad have any comments?
I think I blocked out all memories. Thank you, Joe.
Yeah. who used to run the Jinxes when you were young? Memories of.
We had. Peg Leitner, Tom and Peg hadn't come to Sylvan during those years, so it was way before them. We would have a couple, an adult couple, that would come to Sylvan to run activities. That would be their summer job. I remember the Mahoneys, Mr. and Mrs. Mahoney and their daughter Patty. For a number of years, I think they came from Olean, and they, I think, facilitated in the Jinx program as well as all the other things, activities-wise, at Sylvan. And then there were Lawrence, Mrs. Lawrence came and did the same thing, and she had two sons, Ella and Malcolm.
Did they live in the WAP?
Yeah, they did. And they had the wing, south wing. There was a little apartment on the side, and they would stay there. And I think this, over a period of 6 to 8 years, I know these two couples. There may have been another one, and I think they facilitated into the Jinx program. Again, that would be date-wise, late 30s, early 40s, something like that. Before that, I don't remember. Barb Wagner used to run the Jinx for a number of years. She did. And we'd all, she had a talent for that. But there's a name, certainly. The jinx sort of fell after the 20s. During the 30s, not much happened. I think there were years that we didn't have anything. And I think Barb, we have to give credit to her
for
kind of regenerating the tradition. And then I think the Mahonies and the Lawrences helped a little. But I think Barb is the key.
Yeah, Barb, I think you're right. She was the one that kept it flowing.
Or
at least doing skits on the porch here or there.
Even during the times that the couples were here, the professional couples, I think she was she was the key one.
I think you're right. Do you remember your years in sailing school?
Vaguely.
Do you remember any of your teachers or anything that may have happened?
Neil Manny was my teacher just the 1 year I went to sailing school. We didn't have a 3-year program then. You just went through 1 year and that was it.
That was it. Okay. Do you remember just any part of Sylvan Beach, the maids? Do you ever remember any stories of the maids or any seeing them or any memories of the maids at all?
No, except that there were plenty of them. That was the thing. It's amazing that during the Depression and during the 30s, how people could afford to have maids. I mean, it was a vestige of the past, and but it was curious. I look back on it with sort of, it was very strange.
During the Depression, did you notice that people were more down to earth, do you think?
I think the family values were a heck of a lot better then. Yeah. We were all working together, and there's a lot of fragmentation here that I don't like. A lot of people are going their own ways, and I think there is a closeness that doesn't exist today.
Perhaps another disaster would bring us all back together. It's horrible, but wars and depressions tend to do that.
Well, it's awful to say, but sometimes when we're being tested, we're at our best.
I think you're right. Another famous name from here, Frank Adams. Do you remember Frank Adams?
Through others. I mean, I didn't know him. He was a Hollywood writer, and he wrote lyrics to songs, and he was produced and directed Jinx during the 20s, way before my time. Yes, he...
Can you name for me your peers here? I mean, when you were like 13, 14, you got out of bed. Who did you run and go see? Who were your peers?
About my age was Bruce Stewart, Bill Hodgson, Dwayne Pearson. We had sort of a group that would range, maybe there'd be 4 or 5 years spanning the oldest to the youngest. And then there'd be another group that would be a groupage of a 5-year range by age, boys and girls, particularly in the during the teen years. In the early going, you know, it's whoever was closest that you just happened to see, and there was nothing structured about it. But we structured pretty well in the teenage groups. There were definite groups.
Like all groups.
Like my sister and I were in 2 different groups.
And probably she's very thankful for that, too.
Yeah, well, whatever. And so does that shed any light?
What did you used to do for parties? Did you drink when you were younger here? Did you have parties down on the beach? Was there
beach parties, and singing. We were great in the singing area. Unlike the parties today, where I think there's a lot of talk and discussion and shouting and some things I don't want to hear.
I think our group was the last group to sing. I know it was. Why do you think the singing stopped?
Well,
TV?
We had a lot of dancing too, singing and dancing, and I think during certainly during the 60s, neither was too maybe establishment or traditional, or the songs that during the 60s didn't lend themselves to singing. We'd go back to the 1900s, some of the old ballads that we'd run the gamut all the way through the present. In fact, the old songs are more fun to sing and harmonize to than the new stuff. I think in the 60s you didn't get any of that. I think there is a turn off on dancing and singing with the young group.
Well,
and it just hasn't come back.
We sang with Jimmy and Rock Crow and guys.
Did you?
Like this.
Did you?
We still sang, but we were the last.
Were you the last?
After that.
So there was a curtain that you kind of.
Very.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Between singing and dancing. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Because never liked.
Because the stuff that's going on the beach today is a lot different.
Yeah. No, I wish people would sing again.
In fact, you can edit this out if you want to, but we were checking the beach yesterday. Bill and I, and in fact Ann and I, were checking the contours, and we went into this little hollow that's...
But that's the different age period.
We were talking, Joe, about the singing down on the beach and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The yacht club, there was a back porch, you know, that back thing. Fritz Neumeister, with his screeching tenor, would lead. He'd be the big voice, and we'd all be singing too, and the singing rivaled the dancing. It was such a big deal. Of course, a lot of beer was flowing too, but
a good time was had.
Yeah, and there were these drinking songs. The one with the beer can on your head. Remember that one?
No, I don't remember.
Anyway, we had a lot of fun singing at the yacht club, at the dances in the back porch.
You know, you mentioned Fritz Neumeister, and of all the tapes I've done, it's only the second time he's come up. But he was quite a guy. I remember him.
Yeah, that screeching voice. Yeah,
and he was
penetrating.
Square dances.
Was he?
Yeah, I remember that. As a matter of fact, I remember the night he died. He died at the yacht club.
Oh, he did? I didn't know that.
Yeah, I was sitting next to him, and all of a sudden this man fell over, and he had a heart attack. And
if you have to go, that's not a bad way, right?
No, he was right there at the yacht club and everything else. He used to work in the kitchen all the time. I remember that. Okay, speaking of the... Yacht Club, who were your peers there, and who were your junior commodores? Do you have any specific memories of people that were very good as commodores? Or?
Well, it's the Bill Hodgson, Tom Getz, Christie, Dick Dennison, Doug Partridge, I think, yeah. Those are names that I can remember.
Did you pay dues back then for the junior yacht club?
I don't remember.
You don't remember? Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Do they now?
Yeah.
Oh.
We did too, but it was only like $2.
Yeah. I don't remember that. My guess is no.
What did you do as projects for the junior yacht club? Do you remember anything in particular? White Lake Day, things like that?
Yeah, of course we did White Lake Day, and we had... projects. One thing that might be of interest was we moored our boats out in the lake. We didn't have lifts in those days, and we'd have these storms two or three a year, and all the boats would be dumped, and they'd drag the moorings across the lake, and there'd be pandemonium going on, because we were all very sensitive about damaging our boats. And they could get damaged if they dragged and were washed up on shore, and you could snap a mast easily. So we were always concerned about rescuing our boats while the storm was going on. And like crazy people, we'd go out in little launches and things like that. The lightning would be crashing around, it would be raining, the wind would be driving us, and we'd be trying to facilitate with our damaged and our boats that were being dragged all over. The lights would go out in the yacht club. Mrs. Youngquist would come down every time, and she'd cook coffee for us.
Elsie, yeah.
Yeah, and it was tradition. We'd all run to the yacht club and try and help each other with each other's boats. Those of us that were moored around the lake would you know, we'd stick together, and our groups would that lived close by would help. But we'd be up better part of a night trying to fix these boats.
Sure.
Ignoring the dangers of an electrical storm.
Lightning
hit
it all.
Crazy. Yeah.
Metal stays on your boat.
But that might be of interest, because this was a traditional thing.
Yeah.
And particularly Mrs. Youngquist's participation.
Coming out and making coffee, that's
right.
A That's wild, because that, when I was growing up, we were just the last ones, I think, to have the, our boats were moored out front too.
Were they?
Mm-hmm. Many in the middle of the night, you know, you get up and they have to save type of thing. Do you remember the trumpet player that used to go out?
Oh yeah, sure. Trumpet? John Reitz on Sunday nights.
Memories of that, or?
Well, he was, first of all, he was excellent. And his trumpet was just like a bell. And on a still evening in the middle of the lake, it would go all over the lake, and everybody enjoyed it, and it was just a marvelous thing. Yeah.
Could you hear it on this side?
No.
No.
Okay,
but it just
feels... No, you can't hear this gale on the White Lake side.
Lake side, yeah.
You know, it's just amazing how the windward leeward side of this peninsula insulates.
Yeah, you know, absorbs the sun.
Yeah.
Sound. What in your memory was the worst storm that you've been through up here, or a storm that sticks out as a...
Well, we used to have what we call the annual storm, and we label one per summer as being the one that we thought was most impressive. I can't answer that, Joe. I will say that the wind we had yesterday with gale force winds was, I've never seen Lake Michigan as angry as it was yesterday.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, and that was...
That's 9th. Real, that's current history.
That's
one day old.
But it was that bad.
Yeah. I've never seen Lake Michigan as wild. Now, this isn't to say that the storms that occur in March, you know, that are, I mean, they'll put the one yesterday to shame, perhaps, but I've never seen one of those.
Like yesterday. Okay. Do you have any smells that come to mind when you think of White Lake? Are there any smells of...
The pines. Oh, yeah.
Pines,
oh, yeah.
The
biggest single natural feature that I see about our peninsula is these white pines. And I would wish that there's some way we can reforest these big guys, because...
Maybe for this centennial we should plant a few.
We ought to research it. I was talking to Brooks Applegate the other day, and, you know, these pines are growing at an angle into a slope, and you can't just plant them down because the roots will reemerge, because they go down.
Yeah.
They have to be planted at an angle. I think we ought to do some research in that.
I think it's a good idea.
Because it'd be neat. And you know, the little pine trees grow right next to the big one, I guess for protection. But if you look down the bluff, notice how the smaller pines are adjacent to the bigger ones.
Oh, darn, eh?
So that could be researched too, but I think that'd be neat if we could begin to selectively reforest the white pine.
Maybe each cottage plant too for the centennial.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a good idea, white pine.
Or to do something greenhouse and then transplant it after it's had a chance to...
Yeah, to take root a little bit.
But it's not a function of putting in just pines and hoping that out of 320 of them click. Jack Hansen did that years ago, his first year as caretaker, and he put jack pine in. He put in 300 or something. Nothing happened. And I think it's a function of you got to know, got to research it.
Yeah, I figured out. As Mark said, you said.
Yeah. So I'd love to see, and I'd love to be a part of anything like that next summer, and because the white pine is such a marvelous feature.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah,
and it certainly would be in nowadays because everybody's planting trees nowadays.
Sure.
Back to the lake. Do you remember the lake being higher before, lower before? Why is the lake going up and down? What are your opinions, memories, and thoughts on this issue?
Well, this has been debated. You talk about the locks up north. You talk about the rainfall for the year. I'm sure that we have high water this year because of all the rain in the Midwest. So I'm not going to predict why it's high and why it's low. I'm not even sure that there's cycles. I think it has its own reason for being high and low, and I don't know what it is, and I don't think anybody does. We have pretty high water this year. I think I can remember it being higher. I can remember it being a lot lower.
Oh, yeah.
I remember the White Lake side, you know, the boathouses on the Sylvan side. Most of them had been pushed back because of the high water. But originally, I know the one, our boathouse was significantly further forward. And then there was a marsh in front of it for another 30 feet before the shoreline. And this would have been in the 30s. And
now, did that stay that way for a long
time? For a long time, yeah. And then gradually it receded into a swampy situation where there were frogs and bloodsuckers. And in fact, we used to collect frogs, and that used to be a big pastime for a lot of us. And we'd have to walk through this grime, and we'd get bloodsuckers in our legs and pick them off. And it was real and smelly. A lot of algae in front of and around these boathouses.
What did you do with the frogs?
Yeah, I wondered the other day. We kept them, I guess, and let them go so we could catch them again the next day. Yeah. You know, that type of deal.
Just thing the kids do.
Yeah, and there are two varieties. There are the big spotted ones, and then there were the gray ones, the gray-brown ones.
Has the lake ever been, do you remember when it was low, how low it was, and has it ever been as low after it reached that low that it had? Have we ever gone up and then back down to a time where there was a lot more beach? In your lifetime, what is the lowest of the lake has been?
I remember as a kid, in front of the Middleton Vanderveer, where the Goulds are now, there used to be the bluff went down, and then there was a long stretch of, it was almost like a plateau of a raised dune that had foliage on it, sand grass and that sort of thing. Then there was another little dip, and then the beach, a significant beach. When the Sylvan Beach Hotel was here, the beach went way, way out. Used to have a walk to go down to the beach, and that walk extended a long, long way along the flat side. We had tremendous beaches, bigger than last year. Last year we had low water, and I can remember beaches much larger than that. We had a lot of dune cover, sand grass and bushes in front. The bushes, I don't know what they were, those funny ones with the red berry that you throw at each other, and you know, and it never come out. The stain had never come out. Anyway, lots of bushes, clumps of bushes, as well as the sand grass. So, and the White Lake side, as I described earlier, had this area in front during those years that certainly doesn't exist today and hasn't in the last 25, 30, 30 years. Yeah.
So it was low, and then it went up, kind of, and then we never got back.
We never got back to the low that I remembered in the 30s.
You mentioned, we were talking about the Second World War, and then you mentioned the Korean War. What did you do during that war? Were you drafted? Were mm-hmm. you in college? What happened?
I was drafted, and for 2 years, or as long as the war lasted, unfortunately, and fortunately, it didn't last more than that long. So
were
I was out. I was out. I'd finished college. I was exempt until I graduated, and then I was drafted.
What did
was
you
drafted.
Do during the Korean War?
I was in supply, battalion supply, in the 2nd Armored Division, the 82nd Reconnaissance Battalion. We were into tanks in a big way. Reconnaissance means operating behind the enemy lines, and in case of war, that's where I'd be. And my I was not an officer. I became a corporal after year and a half, and my mission, if there was a war, was to man a machine gun on top of an ammo truck behind the enemy lines. So, we thought that, I always thought that was rather humorous, but fortunately there was no war on that side, and a lot of us were blessed with that.
Oh, good. So you were in Europe during the Korean War.
Yeah, right.
But that was still a hot spot in many.
Yeah, the
blockade.
The Russians used to have maneuvers that ended on May Day every year, and they'd end up at the Iron Curtain. We weren't sure whether they were going to continue through the Iron Curtain or whether they were going to stop. So we were on 24-hour alert for 3 or 4 days.
Did you feel that Russia was a threat?
Sure.
Yeah, I did too. Yeah, and that the Cold War was. Of real Cold War.
Yeah, the Berlin airlift was going on, and a lot of serious stuff going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. What type of cars did you drive when you were young, and at what age did you start to drive?
15. We were allowed to have licenses at 15. None of us could afford to have a car, so we drove our parents' cars. The first car I had was when I was in college. It was a second-hand Chevy, Blue Coupe, as I remember.
Did you drive much up here when you were young? I mean, or did you just mainly walk?
This is such a wonderful place that you don't have to drive anywhere. You can just walk down the street or, we'd drive to the yacht club. No, we didn't. We had boats. We had outboard motors.
Oh, okay, so you had the outboards too?
Yeah, and so the car was not a needed item. Oh, occasionally we'd go to Whitehall to a movie at the Playhouse or the one in Montague. We'd have to drive, or we'd go to Muskegon. But that was an exception. Everything was so self-contained here. The beach down in front, the activities at the yacht club, the WAB club activities, the tennis courts, the golf course close by, the racing, the sailing. I mean, you didn't need a car.
You mentioned your outboards. Did you used to have a group of friends and each one had an outboard?
Yeah,
weigh in them all day?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that was a good.
And anybody that had a 5-horse, boy, that was a real hot item. The one I was using was a 1.5.
Oh, you're kidding me.
And they really moved.
One
it was a Johnson 1.5.
What type of boat did you have?
Big wide thing, safe thing. My father wouldn't have anything else but a big wide boat.
Was it wood or?
Oh yeah.
Was it wood?
Sure. Mahogany.
You had a 1.5 on the boat.
Yeah, and that thing really tore. At least I thought so.
You know, as long as you think so, that's the most.
But anybody that had a 5 was really a speeder.
So you guys used to kind of live in those power boats. You would go down there when you woke up and go over to the island
for sailing
schools.
Some
boat.
More than I. I was sort of, I did other things too, but some just lived on White Lake.
Right, on those boats.
I know the Pearson boys, they were first thing in the morning to the end of the day, why they'd be out on that lake.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
That's great. In your life, or just what do you think are the social changes or changes that have taken place in Sylvan Beach from back then until now? What are some of the differences? Do people party more? Are there more official parties than there used to be? What are some of the changes that you've seen? You've mentioned a couple before. Things are fractionalized now. What are some of the other social changes you've noticed?
It's a deep question. That's something I'd like to think about. I don't notice it. You mean as far as the adult group you're talking?
Or both. Any insight that you have, observations?
Well, I think that the differences are cosmetic. Cocktail parties, they had them then, they have them now. The difference is they'd have a daiquiri cocktail party. That's all they'd serve back then. Or they'd have martinis, period. That's all they'd offer. Here it's an open bar, it's whatever you want. And you'll have wine, beer, whatever kind of liquor that you want to drink. Let's see, daiquiris, what were the other hot drinks? Old-fashioned. That was a staple. Tom Collins's. It just seemed like it wasn't an open bar type of thing. But that's cosmetic. Who the heck cares?
It's same.
The people are still the same. I don't think so. I didn't pay much attention, really. Well, I'm comparing my parents' years with our years.
Right.
I didn't pay that much attention to them. There was always a big deal, the Pirates' Ball. We always had a party. My dad and mother had a party at our house, I think before it or after it or something. Also, they had a party after every annual meeting, or before, I forget. So there'd be sort of annual events would be part of what our family did. As
and
far
you
as
look forward to those types of
things. Yeah.
And I guess we've kind of lost that, too, in a way. With
well, the WOB Club facilitates so beautifully. We didn't use the WOB Club then the way it's being used now as a community center. Private parties for the beach are given at the WOB Club now, which is a wonderful thing. We couldn't do that in the old days. It was just our cottage, Dad and Mother's cottage, held 100 people, believe it or not. But beyond that, we couldn't take any more. No, I think the parties are the same. It's no big deal.
Traditions as important now as they were, do you think?
Traditions
well,
in the
like
sense
the Pirates Ball and things like that, has that waned or dropped off, do you think? Like, for instance, when you were growing up, probably the Jinx, the Pirates Ball, things like that were things that would look forward to that would end the summer. Are those traditions, do you think there's as much tradition and value in tradition as there used to be?
Let me answer it this way. We have more people involved today than we did then. The Yacht Club's membership were the same people in the old days. Very little turnover. The attrition was either by death or somebody moving away or something. And we'd add a few. And but now, I think you've got the Yacht Club. I could be wrong about this, but I think the Yacht Club membership is booming. The golf club has got as many members as they need or want. A lot of new faces, and there didn't seem to be as many new faces then. But that's okay.
Yeah,
that's wonderful.
That's,
who cares? Right. But I think that's a little different. Population in the whole area is boomed. And I think we feel it in our traditions and the people that, because they have to learn the traditions and be part of it. It takes a little time. So the more turnover you have, there's another thing. We used to come up for the whole summer.
Yeah.
Now people don't do that.
That's true.
They come up in relays, in shifts. We haven't been up for a whole summer in 35 years. Ann's up for a month, and I'm up for 2 weeks and maybe a couple long weekends. That's it. In the old days, our parents were up from mid-June to Labor Day.
Why has that changed, do you think?
I think it's easier to travel. It's cheaper to travel. Gas is very inexpensive. We're more mobile. People are flying. Business requirements, I think we feel we have to put in more hours than we used to, maybe. I think there are a lot of reasons for the fact that we don't stay a whole summer anymore.
Yeah.
Used to bring our maid up for the whole summer. Now, the other thing, our families have gotten bigger. Ours has, the Applegates have, every family down the line.
Yeah,
an awful lot of people that want to use the cottage that in the old days it was just one basic family group.
That's a very good point. Excellent point. Excellent. What do you think about the world today? What do you think about the world today? Do you have as much hope as you did when you were growing up? What do you think?
Well, my faith requires me to have the hope. So it's kind of an academic question. I do feel that the more people that you have involved in countries, in cities, in towns, at White Lake, the more you have to deal with people and their needs, the diversities, and so on. When you had fewer people, you had fewer problems.
So the world is
population is a very difficult thing to deal with. in a real practical sense.
Yeah, very much.
All you have to do is pick up the paper.
Were Americans more naive when you were growing up, do you think? And I mean that in a positive
yeah.
way.
Yeah, I believe it.
There was a lot.
The things that we discuss today in the media weren't even whispered about in the 30s and 40s.
We were a lot more ideal when I was young. There was that chance. I was going to grow up and change the
world. It was simpler. Everybody, more, men and women had their roles.
Yeah.
And now it's all up for grabs.
What do you think of that?
I think it's wonderful for those that want the freedom. I think it's unfortunate because I think it breaks down the fiber of family.
Yeah. Why do you think the violence has increased so much?
Partly because of this.
Of the family breakdown.
Yeah. And numbers of people that you deal with.
Yeah, again.
Population again.
Yeah. Yeah. What, for the last question here, if somebody were to look at this in 50 years, what advice do you have to give them, or what thoughts do you have to share? What have you learned during your lifetime that you want to pass on?
Read the Bible.
Read the Bible. Amen. I agree with that. Well, Bud, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. And if there's something you want to add or you think of something, please call me.
Thank you, Joe.
And we'll do it.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
It's been mine. Thank you.